是不是觉得韦伯新发布的照片都特别酷？那我看有多少人已经把手机封面换成了船底座星云了呢？事实上啊，这个才是韦伯真正拍摄到的首批全彩数据。那我知道会有人有疑惑，但是不要紧，我邀请到了下个月马上就要使用韦伯望远镜进行观测的朋友 Yuri，来和大家一起聊聊首批照片背后所涵盖的科学知识。那其实，在2022年7月12日首批照片放出之前呢，NASA 就已经公布了一些工程的照片了。那一来呢，是为了让大家了解韦伯望远镜的近况；二来呢，是为了展露韦伯望远镜的能力。那很多人都注意到了这些照片有一个明显的特点，就是六角或者八角的星芒，包括在正式的照片里呢，也有这些结构。
Here, actually, if you look at the BSF.Look at these bands. They're not stripes anymore. They're like, I don't know, like a,
yeah, I they have a
call it like a snake skin shape. And that's because, and this basically is what happens all the time, but the exact shape of that skin, like the pattern, depends on wavelength. If you have a wide filter, you smooth out a lot of structure and they look like bands.But here you can actually kind of see if you have a better version than this, you can see hexagonal shapes again.
关于它的成因呢，大家可以在弹幕里面刷起来了。对，没错，就是衍射。那衍射的意思就是当波遇到障碍物的时候呢，会偏离原来传播的方向。那这句话听起来可能学术，但想象一个场景，扔一块石头到水中就产生了水波，那水波碰到障碍呢，就发生了偏移。所以接下来你们要把来自远方天体发出来的光想象为水波。这里我们做一个模拟，那左侧是星系恒星发出来的光，那中间是一个圆形的小孔，圆形的光圈，那右侧呢是我们所能看到的景象。那你会发现最终成像是圆环状的。那我们尝试来改变一下这束光的波长以及中间小孔的大小和形状。那同样，我们还可以把圆形小孔换成方形的。再或者，我们换成韦伯的六角形来看一下，就得到了六角的星芒。当然，这还没有结束。那韦伯的主镜呢，是由18块六角镜面构成的，所以最终成像也会变得更加复杂，也就是这个样子。那这个呢，就是韦伯拍摄到的真实数据。那最酷的事情来了，这个小程序呢，可以模拟出来小孔杂乱排列时所呈现的景象。那这个图像呢，就模拟了韦伯刚入轨还未对好焦时所拍到的照片了。那韦伯在入轨后的几个月里呢，做的就是微动这些镜面，使它们准确对焦。另外，支撑次级镜面的三个支架呢，也会产生星芒，原理一样，就是光发生了衍射。那韦伯工程师计算好了角度，特意将这两种方式形成了星芒呢，叠加到了一起，所以最终你会看到一个八角的星芒。那这就成为了韦伯独一无二的指纹。那我们可以再回看一下哈勃望远镜。圆形的光圈，四个支架，那它的指纹就是一个十字。我们回到首次公布的照片上来。
This very bright star you see is actually most of the kind of deep fields don't have such a bright star. The magnitude 12 star, and you can see like huge diffraction spikes. And the purpose of this image is also visual. I mean, for science, those diffraction spikes cause problems, right? They're in the way. You can't avoid them. You will get them.But you can plan your, it depends on what you want to do. If you really have to look at this image, if you then, I mean, you can rotate the telescope a bit, and then the spikes will be in a different position.
Uh-huh.
And then if you do multiple of those rotations, you can basically look behind them. That's one way. That's a bit expensive because you need to rotate the entire telescope, which costs more time. And the other way, you can also just try to model it. So I mean, and then try to subtract the model of the PSF, the point spread function. I'm sure many people are working on that and trying to do that. I mean, you see the lensing.
Yeah,
the foreground cluster, you see the light of the background galaxy being bended. I mean, one of the very stunning things is if you look at the very bright star and follow that diffraction spike basically down, there's like a group of like a few yellowish fluffy things and two orange arcs, and then there's one arc where you see all these very tiny dots around the galaxy.
Yeah,
those are likely globular clusters and stars. The level of detail in that, in those kind of images, is any details you can find distant galaxies, you can learn about the properties of distant galaxies. The gravitational lensing from the cluster will magnify objects and stretch objects, like all the arcs you see. And these arcs basically give you higher spatial resolution to really zoom in on the galaxy. So that's what you can learn about how these clusters form in galaxies. This is my favorite, of course. I mean, this is the, as I said, the images are nice, but the spectroscopy is where all the information is. So they targeted some of the galaxies that are seen here with the NIRSpec, which is a spectrograph, a multi-object spectrograph. And they show four spectra here, which is multiple emission lines detected in these spectra. So you can use those emission lines to measure the redshifts, the distances. And basically, all these measurements are basically new. Perhaps for the first, the top one that could have been done from the ground, I think. But the bottom three, those measurements were impossible to do before. So those were all like record-breaking kind of measurements. Not the most distant galaxies found yet, but these kind of measurements have never been done basically at these distances. Yeah, there's neon, oxygen, hydrogen. There are so in my Top Cat thing, NASA didn't publish this, but I saw this here. Mm-hmm. Where is it? This is another emission line.
Yes.
This is very noisy, I'll admit. But this is exactly at the location where we expect the carbon emission line.
Okay, it's so, carbon.
Carbon 3. So that's, yeah, it's another element detected. Not super surprising, but very nice.
Okay.
So typically the metallicity, as I said, the ratio of these emission lines depends on metallicity, but also on other properties, like the temperature of the gas. And you typically don't know that. There is a very faint emission line that you almost never detect because it's so faint. And that emission line directly tells us the temperature. Well, that's actually this one in the middle, the oxygen line in the middle, which actually doesn't look so faint. That's the oxygen 4363 line, and I think all my colleagues, the first thing we saw when we saw this was, wow, there's neon, wow, there's oxygen 4363. And this basically allows very accurate metallicity measurements. Just realizing that this is a galaxy at redshift 8.6 or 8.5, it's just this blows my mind. I tried to do these measurements at redshift 2, which is much more nearby. And that was already very, very difficult. We only saw these three lines on the right, one neon line. I mean, it's just really hard to.
在韦伯望远镜上呢，还搭载了另外一种成像方式的光谱仪，叫做 Grism Nearase。那它会将整个视线范围内的星光呢，涂抹到一张照片上。你们在图像中看到的每一条线呢，都代表了一个天体所呈现的光谱。那光谱就相当于天体的 DNA。而这一特点呢，恰巧可以用在这张图中。当光源经过引力透镜后呢，会出现多个图像。那我这里用一个手电，一个镜面，就可以模拟这个天文现象了。那你们看，一个点光源，它会变成多个图像，也能变成一个圆弧。那这里的圆弧呢，就是你们刚才在星序族群那张照片中看到的圆弧了。啊，我们可以测量图中这些天体的光谱，你会发现有两个甚至数个图像。它们具有相同的光谱，那这也就说明 这数个图像呢背后其实来自于同一个光源。韦伯的能力呢并没有止步于此，它搭载的近红外和中红外探测仪呢可以穿透星际间的灰尘，揭露出来天体最深处的一面。
Well, so this is quite a few things to highlight here. Like here, this is a couple of galaxies, and the left one is in the foreground, and the other ones are merging together. And what I like about this is that this left one is quite nearby, so we see individual stars. Like we see the individual stars in this distant galaxy. There's lots of things to do. What this nicely shows is that with MIRI, with a mid-infrared camera, you can really zoom in on the center, like in the near-cam image on the left. The centers are basically obscured, like there's like a fuzz, and that's dust. With MIRI, you are in the infrared, so you pierce through the dust. This one, the galaxies look completely different because this really singles out the dusty regions. And you even see like a background galaxy behind this galaxy. Ooh. Shines through the galaxy.
所以有了这些高性能的仪器，天体物理学家可以做些什么呢？我们来听听 Yuri 即将要进行的观测计划。
We actually are going to look at the most massive, supermassive black hole in the early universe.
Wow.
Called J1. It's quasar J100. And it's super bright. That is at redshift 6.3, but it will look like that star. It will have these diffraction spikes.And it actually will likely saturate in our images. So we're going to look at that quasar to see whether it's lensed. It's possible that the quasar is lensed by a foreground galaxy, which makes it brighter than it actually is. But not clear whether that's true or not. And we're going to look at the environment of the quasar. Is it in a very unique, special place in the universe or not?What did the quasar do to the environment? It's the most extreme quasar known at high redshift. It also must have formed very rapidly. We will confirm the black hole mass, whether it's really that massive. So yeah, we're going to do all these cool things next month.
同样也是利用了红外设备可以穿透尘埃和迷雾的能力，在新放出的行星状星云照片中，韦伯甚至可以解析出来中央发光的天体是一个双星系统，包括船体座星云的图像。你看到的这团绚丽的宇宙悬崖，实则是宇宙中高温的气体和尘埃。那这片区域呢，也成为了恒星诞生的一个工厂。那韦伯极强的解析能力和无比的灵敏度，可以探测出来藏在尘埃背后的新星恒星，甚至更远处的背景星系。那在我的视频最开始放了一张韦伯未经加工过的原始照片，那这样的照片呢会经过校正、叠加、拼接等程序，最后合成出来一张科研所用到的照片。那与公众照片相比呢，最大的一个区别就是这张图片上没有那么多绚丽的颜色。这些非常抓人眼球的照片，包括哈勃之前放出来的一系列图像呢，大多都是在后期经过染色等一系列处理得到的景象。所以你们说真实的宇宙应该是什么样子的呢？那韦伯望远镜另外一个研究方向就是探究太阳系以外的行星，它搭载的日冕仪可以遮挡住其他恒星发出来的光，从而让我们可以看到环绕其周围较暗的行星，这也就是直接成像法。还有一种方法叫做凌日法，也就是行星遮挡恒星光，从而发现系外行星。那此法呢，还可以探测到系外行星上的大气成分。那宿主恒星发出来的光穿透其行星大气时呢，大气中的化学成分会在这束光的光谱上留下印记，那这束携带着信息的光就会最终抵达到韦伯望远镜上，就是我们看到的这张照片。那这里我们就发现这颗叫 WASP96b 的行星上是含有水蒸气成分的。那关于系外行星的部分呢，我会在后期视频中邀请到行业大牛和大家详细的介绍一下。好了，这就是这一期视频内容了。那如果你们喜欢物理，喜欢天文，别忘加关注，我们下期再见吧。